March 1945. After weeks of unremitting and desperate fighting, United States forces finally eradicate the last bitterly defended pockets of enemy resistance on a remote Pacific island. In the capture of this 8 square miles of territory, nearly 7,000 lives have been expended. For millions in the United States, the widely syndicated news photograph of the Stars and Stripes being raised over Iwo Jima will provide the most memorable and enduring image of the war. Iwo Jima had been garrisoned by 22,000 Imperial Japanese troops. They were known to be a furious and implacable foe. The assault on and seizure of the island was an undertaking demanding more than ordinary qualities of courage, skill, and resolution. The task was entrusted to units of a unique body of fighting men, whose reputation, then as now, has, like themselves, traveled the world. They were the United States Marines. It was fortunate that so outstanding a force was available. 3 years of World War had seen a dramatic expansion of the Marines to a strength approaching 500,000 men. Yet, for much of its long history, the Marine Corps had been an only moderately sized force, which regularly had been threatened with absorption into the Army or Navy, and even with final disbandment. The immediate precursors of the Marine Corps appeared during the early stages of the War of Independence, when small companies of land troops were attached to individual ships after the fashion of the British Marines. On the 11th of July, 1798, a standing United States Marine Corps was formally established. Initially, the Corps comprised, in all, less than 1,000 men. Over the next 100 years, the Marines remained comparatively few in numbers, but were frequently dispatched overseas when United States interests were perceived as requiring armed intervention or support. Thus, Marines saw action in many places. Towards the end of the 19th century, Marines served with distinction in the war against Spain. And in 1900, they further distinguished themselves by their part in the suppression of the Boxer Revolt in China. At home, these successes brought the Marines a popularity which helped to preserve their independent status once more under threat. The Marine uniform of this period featured a distinctive, well-stiffened collar, which earned for its wearers the abiding colloquial name of the Leathernecks. The Marine Corps was still small. Successive Congresses, foreseeing no possibility of the United States becoming entangled in a major conflict, were reluctant to spend much on any of the armed forces. Soon, all would change. In 1914, Europe stumbled into a foolish and terrible war. Her nations hastened gladly into battle, each confident of rapid and complete victory, each savoring already the glories that awaited. A cruel awakening followed. With the spring of 1915, the warring contenders lay crouched on either side of the mighty battle lines which had riven Europe in twain. The mood in the United States was at first strongly against any involvement in this tumultuous struggle. Gradually, however, a pro-war movement gained ground. And when, early in 1917, Germany took the drastic step of announcing unrestricted submarine warfare, participation in the conflict became inevitable. On the 6th of April, the United States duly entered the war. For immediate purposes, the United States was militarily insignificant. But for reasons of morale, it was desirable to establish even a token presence in Europe as swiftly as possible. Marines were with the first United States troops who landed in France in the summer of 1917. To the dismay of his Allied colleagues, General Pershing insisted that the American Expeditionary Force needed a further 6 months' training to bring it to a proper standard of battle worthiness. As was inevitable after years of inadequate spending, Pershing's hastily assembled units arrived woefully ill-equipped. For their rifles, artillery, tanks, and aircraft, they relied heavily and sometimes exclusively on the French and British. While they completed their training and mastered their new weaponry, the expeditionary force was assigned to a normally quiet section of the front in Lorraine. Pershing's inclination was to use the Marines principally for police and guard duties. However, the Marine commandant insisted his corps was ready to share with the army the first call on the Western Front. To the Great Spring Offensive of 1918, the Germans committed 3.5 million men. Effective new tactics had been developed, and the highly trained stormtroopers scored alarming initial successes. By the end of May, a renewed German assault had penetrated to Chateau Thierry on the Marne, within 50 miles of Paris. Pershing received an urgent request for reinforcements. Nothing in all their history could have prepared the Marines for the unimaginable intensity and horror of the fighting which was to come. For now, in June 1918, their hour of ordeal was to hand. They did not fail. Fighting alongside their no less valorous companions of the regular army, the Marines bore themselves manfully, clinging grimly to their positions despite sustaining repeated heavy casualties. And all the time, they were exacting a fearful toll of the enemy. At Belleau Wood, the German assailants were first brought to a halt, then triumphantly repelled. The Allied lines continued unbroken. A quarter of a million United States troops were now disembarking each month. The long-enduring stalemate finally broken, the Allied armies, and amongst them the Marines, surged onwards towards a stricken and starving Germany. In early November, the armistice was signed. Peace descended at last upon a war-racked and exhausted Europe. The hostilities once over, public sentiment in the United States swung sharply against large military expenditure. After the fame won at Belleau Wood, calls for the Marines to be merged or disbanded were both more muted and less frequent. Nevertheless, the Corps once more shrunk in size, and the old question still persisted. What could the Marines do that the Army or Navy could not also do, and perhaps better? Throughout the 20s and 30s, the Marines were again extensively used in their old colonial policing role. But these so-called banana wars were of far less importance for the Corps' future than the gradual revolution in their training camps and officers' schools. For the Marines were at last creating for themselves a distinctive and modern combat role. One of their finest commandants saw them becoming the advance guard of the army, the first to set foot on hostile soil in order to seize, fortify, and hold a port from which, as a base, the army would prosecute its campaign. In 1933, Marine training was radically reshaped to reflect this new emphasis. From 1935 onwards, major landing exercises were held annually. Steadily, the Marines improved their proficiency in the hazardous techniques of amphibious assault. The lessons learnt were ere long to prove of untold value. For half the globe away, a similar kind of warfare was being practiced, albeit on a far grander scale, and by a very different kind of soldier. Already, Japanese armies had completed the subjugation of Manchuria, and the Imperial troops were pressing southwards down through China. Japan was irrevocably embarked on the quest for territorial aggrandizement. Yet, it was nearer home that the first great storm clouds were gathering. In 1934, the juggernaut of the National Socialist Party carried Adolf Hitler triumphantly to power. And Hitler wanted war. Across the Atlantic, many felt that the United States could safely stand aloof from any troubles, whether in Europe or in the Far East. One consequence was that the United States lagged far behind its potential antagonists in many areas of military technology. There were exceptions. Some outstanding military aircraft, such as the Curtiss dive bomber, were in production. But it was the Air Force of another country which, seizing upon the possibilities opened up by this novel type of warplane, exploited the dive bomber to its fullest and most terrifying effect. Even after Hitler's invasion of Poland in 1939, the isolationist lobby in Washington remained strong. Sympathy, even approval, for Germany's leader was by no means uncommon. The aviator Charles Lindbergh was the most famous and popular spokesman for the non-interventionist cause. Lindbergh regarded Western civilization as under threat from what he described as a pressing sea of yellow, black, and brown. He saw the war as a tragic family quarrel, ominously likely to reduce the strength and destroy the treasures of the white race. He was adamantly against giving Britain any aid whatsoever. President Roosevelt, by contrast, was firmly convinced of Hitler's essential evil, and alert, too, to the nascent menace in the Pacific. After the outbreak of war in Europe, he swiftly assumed powers, enabling him to increase the strength of the armed forces. The Marine Corps was expanded to 25,000 men, but, as in the other services, weapons and equipment for them were in short supply. The neglect of years could not quickly be remedied. Some newsreel of troops at training found its way to Berlin, where it afforded Adolf Hitler much amusement. In 1940, Germany's dictator had much other cause for satisfaction. His armies had won him mastery of Western continental Europe. Britain only held out unsubdued, despite fierce attack from the air and from under the sea. Hitler's attention turned eastwards, and in June of the following year, he launched his fateful invasion of the Soviet Union. Whilst these momentous events unfolded, the Marine Corps was constantly working to build up its numbers and perfect its battle readiness. Passing out as a Marine was never easy. The much-admired basic training course was of legendary toughness. During his 8 weeks at boot school, as the camps were called, the hopeful recruit underwent a grueling regimen, which filled every instant of the 16 waking hours of every day. Yet, if it was arduous, it had to be. For the raw and often immature young men had to be fashioned into physically and psychologically hardened warriors, able not just to go out and fight for their country, but also, if possible, to come back alive. All this while, Japan's unbridled appetite for expansion was making some sort of clash ever more likely. Amidst rising tension, the United States imposed a trade embargo. In November 1941, ultimata were exchanged. When negotiations broke down, the Japanese were ready with their response. Their most gifted strategist, Admiral Yamamoto, had drawn up plans for an air and sea offensive of extraordinary audacity. His carrier fleet was already moving into position. A remarkable series of oversights and coincidences, not fully explicable even after 50 years, allowed the Japanese to achieve complete and devastating surprise at Pearl Harbor. The first target struck was a Marine airfield, where swarms of Japanese Zeros destroyed lines of fighters on the ground. The Marines responded with fire from rifles, pistols, and even machine guns from disabled aircraft. Within 2 minutes, the main attack on the harbor had commenced. When it finished, over 2,000 Marines and sailors were dead or dying. In their homeland, the news was received with shock and fury. It was a profound blow to national self-esteem. And soon, emboldened by his allies' dramatic success, Hitler too declared war on the United States. The nation was now embroiled in a global conflict for which she was far from adequately prepared. The Japanese Pacific Offensive had been thoroughly planned and was put into effect with terrifying efficiency. Pearl Harbor was followed up directly by a series of further violent attacks. More than once, Marines found themselves in the front line. At Guam, far outnumbered, they put up a spirited fight before the inevitable capitulation. On the tiny atoll of Wake Island, the 450 Marines had no radar and were badly hit by repeated bombing and strafing. Nonetheless, their shore batteries and few surviving aircraft beat off strong invasion forces, sinking the first Japanese warship of the war. After holding out for 16 heroic days, the garrison succumbed to overwhelming odds. Besides largely incapacitating the Pacific Fleet, the Japanese raids had eliminated hundreds of aircraft on the ground. Dominant now in air and sea, the Japanese rampaged impetuously onwards. Marines were again caught up in the fighting for the Philippines, a vital strategic objective. Large Imperial forces landed in late December and were soon driving on Manila. Consolidating his troops on the malaria-ridden Bataan Peninsula and on the fortress island of Corregidor, General Douglas MacArthur prepared a determined stand. The defenders, though desperately short of food and medicines, fought on unyieldingly, compelling the Japanese to draw off and await the arrival of fresh troops. Meanwhile, Roosevelt had decided, reluctantly, not to send reinforcements. MacArthur was ordered out. For the Japanese, no land campaign had been so trying, so long, or so costly. But at length, after 5 months, the last organized resistance on the Philippines was extinguished. General Wainwright surrendered in order to avert needless slaughter of his men. But for the starving defenders of Corregidor and those who surrendered elsewhere in the Pacific, death might have seemed preferable to the captivity that awaited. Beatings, executions, death marches, and camps run under conditions of excoriating harshness. The unvarying callousness with which the Japanese treated their prisoners added a raw, bitter edge to all the fighting in the Pacific. After the fall of the Philippines, the Japanese circle of conquest was spread well nigh to its fullest extent. Yamamoto had warned that although Japan might at first enjoy unrivaled triumph, after 6 months or thereabouts, the United States would begin to reassert itself militarily in eventually irresistible strength. His prescience would prove unerring. In May and June of 1942, the naval battles of the Coral Sea and Midway effectively set a limit to any further Japanese expansion. There remained the formidable task of wresting back the numerous islands and territories they had seized in their tempestuous course of conquest. It was a task for which the Marine Corps was preeminently well prepared, and the Pacific, not Europe, would be the Marines' theater of war. More than any other service arm, they had specialized in amphibious assault. Their combat troops had trained for it. Their pilots were extensively practiced in the necessary support roles. Above all, the Corps had at last acquired properly serviceable landing craft, capable of sailing directly onto hostile beaches for the speedy disembarkation of men and vehicles. Now their skills and methods were to be tested in the fires of actual battle. The long work of reconquest commenced in August 1942, when Marines went ashore on Guadalcanal and Tulagi in the Solomon Islands. On the beaches, opposition was light. But thereafter, the enemy responded ferociously. And for some days, the Marines were deprived of naval and air support. As the Japanese sent in thousands of reinforcements, a succession of dramatic naval engagements took place. Over the next months, the Marines beat back reiterated violent counterattacks and inexorably consolidated their grip on the island. Increasingly hemmed about and with their sea links imperiled, the Japanese evacuated their last 13,000 troops. By February 1943, the hard-fought victory was won. The fighting on Guadalcanal set the pattern for innumerable subsequent operations in the Pacific. In the racking, unremitting mental strains imposed, no less than the daunting demands made on sinews and stamina. It was a type of warfare as hard as any in the world. In the humid, enervating climate, disease and infection spread swiftly. Small wounds were often fatal. Amidst all this, the Marines were pitted against a hardy and tenacious adversary, proficient in the arts of jungle warfare and driven on by a burning devotion to the honor and glory of Nippon. Masters of concealment and ambush, the Japanese rarely surrendered, and no tract of terrain could be accounted safe until every last individual enemy soldier had been dealt with. Whilst the Marines were clearing Guadalcanal, Australian and United States troops under General MacArthur were engaged in a similarly testing campaign in Papua, most of which was secured by early 1943. The initiative had passed decisively to the United States and her allies. The strategy that now evolved postulated two enormous lines of attack. MacArthur's troops would drive onwards into New Guinea and from thence fall upon the island chains of the southwest. Forces under Admiral Nimitz would make the second thrust, through the scattered islands of the central eastern Pacific. The two great pincers would converge on the Philippines. In the unrelievedly bloody campaigning along the so-called Solomon's Ladder, the services of the Marine Corps were heavily in requisition. Marines were successively in action in New Georgia, Swaziel, and Bougainville. And as the year drew to a close, they were scouring through Cape Gloucester in New Britain. Invariably, the Japanese resistance was of the fiercest. And it was not mere bravery, nor outstanding physical resilience, nor skill with weapons that carried the Marines at last triumphant through so many grim and fearful passages. The Marines owned, besides, an unusually strong sense of cohesion. Fighting together, each man knew he could depend absolutely on his fellows, and their battle effectiveness was thereby much enhanced. Indeed, theirs was a companionship which extended beyond death itself. Notably, the Marines always attempted to recover the body of a fallen comrade, often returning under enemy fire to do so. Hard though they were, the campaigns of 1943 yielded useful lessons and experience. It was realized that, given the vast distances involved, it was not necessary to attack and reduce every single Japanese outpost. Often, enemy-occupied islands or bases could simply be bypassed. Then, their sea and air links once severed, these garrisons were effectively neutralized and could be left to wither on the vine. The Central Pacific Offensive began only in December, with its first objective, the Gilbert Islands. Here, a contingent of Marines came close to outright disaster. At Tarawa Atoll, they mounted an amphibious assault against an islet only half a square mile in area. But the several thousand Japanese defenders were well prepared, and an ineffectual preliminary bombardment had left their fortifications virtually intact. To seize this tiny scrap of land took the Marines 3 days at the price of 1,000 dead. The debacle at Tarawa prompted an urgent, thoroughgoing reappraisal of tactics and equipment. Better landing craft and amphibious vehicles more suited to the treacherous coral reefs were commissioned. Improved communication systems and more effective weaponry were introduced. The eventual outcome was that the Marines significantly increased their capability and proficiency in the art of amphibious warfare. In the European War, the year 1944 would see Hitler's empire brought to the verge of utter ruin. The Western Allies were already entrenched in Italy and preparing for a gigantic combined assault on Normandy. Their bombers were incessantly at work, wreaking even more devastation on Germany's cities. Most ominous of all for Germany's leader were the portents from the Eastern Front. It was here that his finest armies had been broken and ground down. Here that the greater part of his armed strength must always be committed. And it was here that month by month, his soldiers would be relentlessly driven back in their longest, most calamitous retreat. ...1944 saw the Marines in action in two major island chains. The first, the Marshall's Group, was dealt with relative ease. But the strategically important Marianas proved an altogether more exacting affair. The fighting on Saipan, Guam, and Tinian in the summer, and perhaps even more, that on the Caroline island of Peleliu in the autumn, was as strenuous, as vicious, and as bloody as any the Marines had experienced. In these battles, the Marines were closed with an enemy for whom death was not merely preferable to dishonor, but the sole alternative to unthinkable disgrace. On Saipan, the Marines were subjected to the most violent banzai attack of the war, when 3,000 Japanese troops, frenzied with sake and resolved to die for their emperor, threw themselves suicidally against the Marines' position. In the larger conflict, the dogged heroism of the Marines earned valuable dividends. Their assault on Saipan compelled the Japanese 1st Mobile Fleet out to battle. It was destroyed forthwith, as were hundreds of naval aircraft. The capture of the Marianas brought the Japanese home islands within range of the United States Super Fortress bombers. From the airfield at Tinian, the war's most awesome weapon would be launched. On the other arm of the vast pincer, MacArthur's landings in the central Philippines forced a second and conclusive series of naval engagements. After the Battle of Leyte Gulf in October 1944, the Imperial Navy was no longer a significant force. Its remaining vessels were short of fuel, as well as lacking adequate air cover. Moreover, the Japanese war machine was in critical straits. With limited natural resources, Japan was heavily or solely dependent on regular large imports to sustain her war industries. And in a stealthy but relentless campaign, United States submarines were methodically completing the destruction of Japan's merchant marine. At the end of 1944, the military planners perhaps did not fully appreciate the magnitude of what had been already accomplished. In any case, before moving on to the final objective, an invasion of Japan itself, the strategists decided that they needed to capture more islands, partly in order to gain advanced fighter bases to support the bombing offensive. The planners fixed on the islands of Iwo Jima and Okinawa. Iwo Jima, a bleak and normally uninhabited volcanic outcrop 4 miles long, was garrisoned by around 22,000 Japanese troops. They knew there was no possibility of their receiving reinforcements. From early December, Iwo Jima was subjected to daily bombing raids. From the 3rd of January onwards, there were nightly raids as well. The landing was scheduled for the 19th of February, 1945. 3 divisions of Marines were assigned to the capture of Iwo Jima. It was hoped the operation would be over within 4 days. For much of their earlier history, the Marines had been the least regarded of the armed services. For many decades, the pay of the Marines and even their rations had been less than that of the sailors on whose ships they served. A Marine officer had been deemed inferior to his Navy equivalent. Now, Marines were being called upon to perform one of the most difficult and hazardous tasks of modern warfare: a seaborne assault on unfriendly shores. They knew that although combined aerial and naval bombardment could do much, it could never of itself suffice to break a resourceful and well-prepared defender. They knew that ultimately, someone had physically to go in and force a landing by men establishing a beachhead, by men ready to carry the fight up to the face of the enemy and on to his own ground. The invasion convoy came under attack from kamikaze missions. Most were shot down. But to the Marines, it was a reminder of what they well knew, that to this foe, surrender was infamy. For 3 days before the landings, an intense naval barrage was directed upon Iwo Jima. But as the Marines at last went in, withering enemy fire made it quickly apparent that the largest preliminary bombardment of all the Pacific War had achieved only negligible results. Caught in an incessant hail of heavy mortar and artillery fire, the Marines were for many hours pinned down on the beaches. That first day, they suffered 2,500 casualties. Inch by terrible inch, utilizing every last scrap of cover, the Marines persevered, pressing grimly and stubbornly onwards. A bridgehead was secured and consolidated. The Marines could call on ample air and naval support. For all that, they still faced a task of intimidating and awesome dimensions. The Japanese had made expert use of those two powerful implements of defensive warfare, the pick and the shovel. Besides its natural caves, the volcanic rock of Mount Suribachi was honeycombed with bunkers, concealed fortifications and vantage points, connected by deep-hewn tunnels. Somehow, the Marines would have to destroy, capture, or neutralize every one of these. Often in past campaigns, when defeat was clearly unavoidable, the Japanese had launched desperate counterattacks in which many of them were killed. This would not be repeated on Iwo Jima, where General Kuribayashi was determined not to squander his men in useless, vainglorious onslaughts. They would sell their lives as dearly as may be, and Kuribayashi knew that for the individual Japanese soldier, the battle would cease only with the finality of death. So far from being over in 4 days, the ferocious fighting went on for over 5 weeks until the 26th of March. In the end, Iwo Jima was only conquered because the Marines crawled up Mount Suribachi on their bellies, encountering and overcoming furious opposition on every part of the way. Virtually all of the Japanese garrison was killed, and with them, some 6,800 Marines. The overall casualty rate for the landing force was of the order of 30%. Admiral Nimitz commented that on Iwo Jima, uncommon valor was a common virtue. And even by the Marines' own standards, they had given an outstanding display of assiduous and unflinching bravery. It must be doubtful whether any other troops could have done it. Far away, two vast Red Army fronts were massing for an overwhelming final offensive. Behind them lay untold millions of German and Soviet dead. In front, a shattered and blasted Berlin. On the other side of Germany, Allied forces were advancing on the roar. For Hitler's thousand-year empire, the last hour had struck. But in the Pacific, the war went on, with no imminent end in sight. For the assault on Okinawa, 3 Marine and 4 Army divisions were committed. The 60-mile-long island was held by 130,000 troops of the Japanese 32nd Army. The defenders having withdrawn inland, an intense preliminary bombardment fell on empty beaches. And on the 1st of April, landings went ahead without opposition. As soldiers and Marines pressed southwards on Okinawa, resistance quickly stiffened. 3 more months of unremittingly bitter fighting ensued as the Japanese were gradually driven back into a last redoubt on the southern tip of the island. As the struggle raged on land, a series of massed kamikaze raids were launched against the supporting naval units, damaging or sinking many ships. It was an ominous presagement for the future when the time came for Japan itself to be invaded. Though hemmed in and hopeless of succor, the Japanese troops fought obstinately and fiercely to the end, being dislodged from their dugouts and emplacements only by the extensive use of flamethrowers. When the conquest was finally completed on June the 22nd, the Army, Navy, and Marines had sustained total casualties of 50,000, making Okinawa the costliest of all the Pacific operations. But the gateway to the Japanese home islands now stood wide open. Since the capture of the Marianas, Japan had been the target of increasingly heavy bombing. In spring, General Curtis LeMay had switched his bombers to mass nighttime incendiary raids with dramatic results. On March the 9th, a quarter of Tokyo was obliterated and 80,000 people killed. Similar strikes against other major industrial cities followed. Plans to invade Japan went ahead. An amphibious assault fleet even larger than that employed for Normandy was envisaged, supported by 8,000 aircraft. The Marines and their comrades were braced for what they believed would be their last and most horrific battle. But in fact, Japan and her emperor were already seeking peace. Overtures had been made to the Soviet Union. Nevertheless, for a variety of reasons, President Truman decided to demonstrate his newest weapon. On August the 6th, a trio of B-29s took off from the airstrip at Tinian. Between them, they carried only one bomb. Their mission was completed successfully, and the world had entered the atomic age. After a second bomb was dropped 3 days later, Japan announced her capitulation. The instrument of surrender was formally accepted on board the USS Missouri in Tokyo Harbor on the 2nd of September 1945. Marines landed in Japan, but only as occupation troops. The Pacific War, in which the Marine Corps had played so prominent and courageous a part, was finally at an end. The bitter, protracted conflict had claimed the lives of 20,000 of their number. Another 70,000 had been injured. The long-awaited peace brought irresistible public pressure for drastic reductions in the armed forces. Within 3 years, the Marine Corps had diminished to 70,000 men, less than one-sixth of its wartime establishment. Moreover, since it was believed atomic bombs had rendered all other weaponry obsolete, there was scant funding for conventional forces. Although the Marines were enthusiastic about the new helicopters just then being developed, they were able to acquire only a handful. Throughout the immediate post-war years, United States defense policy was a subject of widespread controversy, and the integrity of the Marine Corps seemed yet again in jeopardy. The debate abruptly subsided in June 1950, when without warning, the North Korean People's Army swept through the demarcation lines and down into the southern part of the partitioned country. Pitifully few effective reinforcements were available, and their armor was outclassed by the powerful Soviet-built tanks. Suddenly, the Marines were needed again. Units were hurried in to bolster the defenses of the last southern redoubt, round Pusan. The perimeter was stabilized. Then General MacArthur prepared to deliver an astonishing riposte using the last of his reserves. The risks were enormous. September found the Marines spearheading a large amphibious assault force making for Incheon on the western coast. Amongst them were many reservists, hastily recalled to the colors. Some vessels sailed unscarred of actual rust. They approached through shallow, treacherous mudflats. At dawn on the 15th, the harbor's island defenses were secured. At dusk the same day, the main landing went ahead. There was no beach, only a high sea wall. The sheer audacity of the undertaking contributed largely to its success. By the next day, Marines and infantry were driving hard for the capital, Seoul, 25 miles distant. In the east, the 8th Army moved out of Pusan and thrust sharply northwards. Despite fierce resistance, Seoul was taken, leaving over 150,000 troops of the People's Army cut off and trapped in the south. Most were either captured or killed. Within a fortnight, MacArthur's strategic masterstroke had completely transformed the war situation. The fighting in Korea continued, leading to intervention by the Chinese army. But before long, the front had reverted nearly to the position of the original demarcation line, and an enduring stalemate supervened. In 1951, the separate status of the Marine Corps was at last permanently guaranteed in a bill passed by Congress. The active establishment was permanently fixed at 3 divisions and 3 air wings. The next war in which the Marines fought would be in many ways the worst. It would bring no victory and little honor. It was the long agony of Vietnam. For the Marines, the Vietnam War began in earnest in 1965, when they were ordered to a major base at Da Nang, initially for purely defensive purposes. Inevitably, that role expanded, and by the next year, the Marines were routinely carrying out search and destroy missions. When they could locate enemy units, the Marines generally won the ensuing battle. But the enemy was frustratingly elusive. And although the United States steadily committed more and more forces, backed by massive strike capabilities and deploying awesome firepower, the prospect of decisive victory remained depressingly remote. For the Marines, Vietnam was not a happy war. In Japan, they had fought a foe who, though deadly, was at least readily identifiable as such. In this murky war of shadows, the enemy did not always appear in uniform. The villager, whose well they dug today, might be the saboteur who tomorrow would slip through their lines intent on some foul errand of destruction. In the Pacific, too, the justness of the cause had been beyond question. And when troops returned home, the nation had hailed them as heroes. But over Vietnam, the United States was bitterly divided. The client South Vietnamese government was regularly exposed as extravagantly corrupt. And there were many who questioned the morality as well as the efficacy of some of the means by which democracy was being defended. But a soldier's duty was to fight, not to question the orders of his political masters, though many a soldier did. The Marines fought on. Many of their comrades perished, many were maimed, and many more again returned home with those invisible but no less grievous wounds of the spirit, never again to be whole. The climactic campaign of the war was the North Vietnamese Tet Offensive of 1968. In terms of numbers killed and captured, the attackers lost heavily. But in the more important battle, the battle that was being fought nightly on the television screens of the world, their victory was overwhelming. The next year, the United States began withdrawing its forces. When the South Vietnamese government finally fell in 1975, Marine helicopters flew in to evacuate the remaining embassy staff. After Vietnam, the Marines reverted to their well-established role as a highly mobile expeditionary force, instantly ready for service in any part of the world. During the 80s, they saw service in the Lebanon, where 254 Marines and naval personnel on peacekeeping duties were killed by a terrorist bomb, in Grenada and in Panama. The United States still needs its Marine Corps. Modern military technology is capable of remarkable things, but ultimately, if a piece of territory is to be secured, then it can be done only by men going in physically to assert control on the ground. Of all military operations, this is one of the most unfailingly hazardous. It is also a task that the Marines have been called upon to perform many times and in many places. And their reputation, like themselves, has traveled the world.